भगवते वासुदेवाय।
ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय।
ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय।
ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय।
नारायणं नमस्कृत्यं
नारायणं नमस्कृत्यं
नरं चैव नरोत्तमं
नरं चैव नरोत्तमं
देवीं सरस्वतीं व्यासं
देवीं सरस्वतीं व्यासं
ततो जया मुदीरये नष्टप्रायेष भद्रेषु
नष्टप्रायेष भद्रेषु
नित्यं भागवत सेवया
नित्यं भागवत सेवया
भगवती उत्तम श्लोके
भगवती उत्तम श्लोके
भक्ति भवति नैष्ठिकी
भक्ति भवति नैष्ठिकी।
रीडिंग फ्रॉम श्रीमद् भागवतम कैंटो 2 चैप्टर 3 टेक्स्ट 10। अकामः सर्वकामः वा अकामः सर्वकामो वा मोक्षकामा उदारधी मोक्षकामा उदारधी तीव्रेण भक्तियोगेन तीव्रेण भक्तियोगेन यजेता पुरुषं परं यजेता पुरुषं परं अकामः सर्वकामो वा मोक्षकामा उदारधि तीव्रेण भक्तियोगेन यजेता पुरुषं परं। One who has transcended all material desires. Sarvakamaha, one who has the sum total of material desires. Va, either Mokshakamaha, one who desires liberation. Udaradhi, with broader intelligence. Tivrena, with great force. Bhakti Yogena, by devotional service to the Lord. Ejeta, should worship Purusham, the Lord. Param, द सुप्रीम होल ट्रांसलेशन परपोर्ट बाय डिवाइन ग्रेस ए सी भक्तिवेदांत स्वामी श्री प्रभुपाद ट्रांसलेशन ए पर्सन हु हैज ब्रॉडर इंटेलिजेंस whether he be full of all material desires, without any material desire, or desiring liberation, must by all means worship the Supreme Whole, the Personality of Godhead. Please repeat, a person who has broader intelligence, whether he be full of all material desire, without any material desire,
are desiring liberation,
must by all means
worship the Supreme Whole, the Personality of Godhead.
Purport by Shri Prabhupada. The Supreme Personality of Godhead, Lord Shri Krishna, is described in the Bhagavad Gita as Purushottama, or the Supreme Personality. It is He only who can award liberation to the impersonalists by absorbing such aspirants in the Brahma Jyoti, the bodily rays of the Lord. The Brahma Jyoti is not separate from the Lord, as the glowing sun ray is not independent of the sun disk. Therefore, one who desires to merge into the supreme impersonal Brahma Jyoti must also worship the Lord by Bhakti Yoga, as recommended here in the Srimad Bhagavatam. Bhakti Yoga is especially stressed here as the means of all perfection. In the previous chapters, it has been stated that Bhakti Yoga is the ultimate goal of both Karma Yoga and Jnana Yoga. And in the same way, in this chapter, it is emphatically declared that Bhakti Yoga is the ultimate goal of the different varieties of worship of the different demigods. Bhakti Yoga, thus being the supreme means of self-realization, is recommended here. Everyone must therefore seriously take up the methods of Bhakti Yoga, even though one aspires for material enjoyment or liberation from material bondage. Akamaha is one who has no material desire. A living being, naturally, being the part and parcel of the Supreme Whole, Purusham Purnam, is a natural function to serve the Supreme Being, just as the parts and parcels of the body or the limbs of the body are naturally meant to serve the complete body. Desireless means, therefore, not to be inert like the stone, but to be conscious of one's actual position and thus desire satisfaction only from the Supreme Lord. Srila Jiva Goswami has explained this desirelessness as bhajaniya parma purusha sukamatrasva swasukatvam in his sandarbha. This means that one should feel happy only by experiencing the happiness of the Supreme Lord. This intuition of the living being is sometimes manifested even during the conditioned stage of a living being in the material world. And such intuition is expressed in the manner of altruism, philanthropy, socialism, communism, etc. by the undeveloped minds of less intelligent persons. In the mundane field, such an outlook of doing good to others in the form of society, community, family, country or humanity is a partial manifestation of the same original feeling in which a pure living entity feels happiness by the happiness of the Supreme Lord. Such superb feelings were exhibited by the damsels of Rajabhumi for the happiness of the Lord. The gopis loved the Lord without any return, and this is the perfect exhibition of the Akama spirit. Kama spirit, or the desire for one's own satisfaction, is fully exhibited in the material world, whereas the spirit of Akama is fully exhibited in the spiritual world. Thoughts of becoming one with the Lord or being merged in the Brahma Jyoti can also be exhibitions of Kama spirit if they are desires for one's own satisfaction to be free from the material miseries. A pure devotee does not want liberation so that he may be relieved from the miseries of life. Even without so-called liberation, a pure devotee is aspirant for the satisfaction of the Lord. Influenced by the Kama spirit, Arjuna declined to fight in Kurukshetra battlefield because he wanted to save his relatives for his own satisfaction. By being a pure devotee, he agreed to fight on the instruction of the Lord because he came to his senses and realized that satisfaction of the Lord at the cost of his own satisfaction was his prime duty. Thus he became a Kama. That is the perfect stage of a perfect living being. Udharadhi means one who has a broader outlook. People with desires for material enjoyment must worship small demigods, and such intelligence is condemned in the Bhagavad Gita as Hrutajnana, the intelligence of one who has lost his senses. One cannot obtain any result from demigods without getting sanction from the Supreme Lord. Therefore, a person with a broader outlook can see that the ultimate authority is the Lord, even for material benefits. Under the circumstances, one with a broader outlook, even with the desire for material enjoyment or for liberation, should take to the worship of the Lord directly. And everyone, whether in akama, asakama, mokshakama, should worship the Lord with great expedience. This implies that bhakti yoga may be perfectly administered without any mixture of karma and jnana. As the unmixed sun ray is very forceful and is therefore called tivra, similarly, unmixed bhakti yoga of hearing and chanting may be preferred by one and all, regardless of inner motive. Presents the Bhaktivedanta Purport. Om Ajnana Timiran Dasya Gananjana Shalakaya Chakshurun Militam Ena Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha. Nama Om Vishnu Padaya Krishna Prishtaya Bhutale Srimate Bhakti Vedanta Swaminiti Namine. Namaste Saraswate Deve Gauravani Pracharine Shesha Shunyavadi Pashyata Deshatarine. श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानंद श्री अद्वैत गदाधर श्रीवासादि गौरभक्तवृंद हरे कृष्णा कृष्ण कृष्ण हरे 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 राम 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 हरे हरे. सो रिसेंटली देयर द आउटसाइड पीपल they are talking about the change in climate all over the world, and they are discussing about a big problem called global waste problem. People are generating waste every day. And so they are worried how to handle this waste. For example, everybody uses a mobile. And once you purchase the mobile and use it, say in 3 months or 3 years, the mobile becomes outdated. Outdated means some technology will change, some operating system will change. That fellow will say no more upgrades. Operating system is fully changed, so you have to change your mobile, he'll say. Previously it was not like that. Once you purchase a gadget, it is there. So, once you throw that mobile into the dustbin, it becomes a waste, garbage. Now, what to do with it? How do you handle this waste? Why? Because these are all made out of very strong elements. You know, asbestos and so many things are there inside the mobile. Outside it looks very nice, but inside it's all heavy metals, dangerous chemicals. Now how do you handle this waste? And then how many mobiles, the billions of mobiles are there in the planet? And everybody is throwing. They say there is 2.12 billion tons of waste every year. 2.12 billion tons. It's a huge. And see, if there is a tree is there, one branch becomes dry and it falls off, or some leaves falls off, that is also waste. Municipality will come and clean it up and take it away. And our mobile is also there, thrown, waste, because it's no more useful. Now, the other waste, they call it as bio-waste, and that is very easy to manage. All these leaves and whatever is there, you put it under, it becomes a fertilizer, very useful. But what happens to the mobile? You throw it into the land, it will remain like that only. And not only it remains like that, it takes decades for that mobile to get degraded and become part of the earth. It takes hundreds of years on mobile. And now you have 1 billion mobiles to be digested into the earth. What will you do? They are unable to understand. They throw it into rivers and oceans. And in the ocean, all these fish and everybody, they swallow these mobiles and they have their own issues. In Hingonia Ghoshala, we see many cows come there and they are suffering. And when you open up their stomachs by a surgery, you can see cages of plastic, including small gadgets the cow will be swallowing, because it doesn't know what it is, looking for food, and it thinks it's a food. So this is destroying the whole ecology of the environment. The human generated, artificially generated waste is a big issue. So they were analyzing why so much of waste is generated by human beings, like this, mobiles and this and that. They figured out that 99% of this waste is because most of the people change. They throw it away in 6 months. Now they purchase something and within 6 months they discard. Imagine there are almost 8 to 9 billion people on the planet, and they are all purchasing and throwing, discarding. What will you do all this? They don't get digested into the earth. So you dump here and there, that's the problem. Now why are they purchasing more? You go to any mall, you will see people happily come out with dozens of bags, carrying like this, full of items. Some are required, some may not be required. By the trick of those departmental stores, they purchase more. When they come back to the house, sometimes they may not even find space. It's like that. Now why are they purchasing? Sarvakama. They have full of desires. Prabhupada is translating this as sum total of material desires. They have all the desires. So that's why they cannot distinguish to purchase or not purchase. Particularly when they say free, immediately there is a tension, because they'll say free up to so and so date. Christmas are free or discounted. Now Christmas is coming, so Christmas discount sales. Are they may combine Christmas and Sankranti sales? They'll put 60% discount up to so and so date. Immediately there is an anxiety. 60% discount, you will not get again. Right? So whether they required or not, they immediately purchase. Houses are full of items, cupboards are full of clothes, and you know, everything is packed. This is how it is. And in the next season again they have to purchase, you know, 5-6 bags. So they have to throw some whatever is available, or they have to increase more cupboards. There is a race. This is called sarvakama, full of desires. When we were living in Hyderabad, rented house like this, opposite to the big houses. One house he has 6 cars inside parked, this apartment or whatever. Another 4 cars are parked outside. He doesn't have parking space. Why? Because each family member requires 2 cars. Right? So they used to park in front of our room and this and that. Now why so many cars? Why so many of those gadgets? Why all those increase of all these necessities? Because they serve kama. People are chasing all these products, thinking that these products will make us happy. The whole economy is built on this. How much you can consume, how much you can purchase and consume. If you consume more, you will be happy. And then what they do, these manufacturers, whether you have desire or no desire, they will do nice advertisement. They will do marketing and advertisement, and they will project, if you don't take this product, then you will not be happy. And with the product, they'll put one woman advertisement, they'll put one, and that's all. Everybody will feel that it is important in their lives. Like that, they drive you into a race of acquiring more and more products, whether it is really required or not. Very rarely we see moksha kamis, generally old people. Who knows what is moksha? You know, only very few. And there also he'll put one advertisement in. I saw there is one advertisement. It's an advertisement of a shoe. And he'll say, attain moksha. Shoes are there. Just by wearing shoes, one can attain moksha. So, like that, Prabhupada used to comment on these advertisements. There was a big advertisement of cigarette. And then it says, cool. You smoke cigarette, it will be cool. The Prabhupada points out, see how it is paradoxical, contradictory. You are smoking fire and you want cool. You want to be cool, it's not possible. We see akama. Akamas are very rare. No material desires. It is possible only for pure devotees. Very, very rare. Then sarvakama, that we see every day. Full of desires. Running, chasing. How to fulfill their desires is a big goal. And then mokshakama. Mokshakama means the desires of freedom from miseries, harassed by diseases, harassed by some troubles in the mind. They desire freedom from them, freedom from those miseries and troubles. That very desire to get free is called mokshakama. Sometimes they may not even desire to go out of this material world, all those things, but even the very desire to get free from the troubles and miseries of life, that is also mokshaka. But there is a category where they specifically desire to go and merge into the Brahma Jyoti. Many people, they don't know what is moksha means. They simply think we have to merge into the deity. Sometimes they believe that they can, you know, there is a Vaikuntha. I was asking one of those followers, he is a very famous Acharya in Andhra and Telangana. One of his disciples, we were discussing, what is your ultimate goal? So he said, yes, we want to go back to Vaikuntha. I said, oh, very, very nice. After going there, what will you do? No, there is Paramatma there. And then we'll go and merge into the Paramatma. That's what he mentioned. Recently we had some installation ceremony, some archakas have come from some famous place. And during some of the festivities we were discussing with the archakas. He was telling there is Vaikuntha. So again I'm very keenly listening, what is this goal? We will go there, there won't be any hunger, there is no thirst there, because we are so attracted to the Lord. There is no eating, there is no sleeping, there is no any of those. And then we will also become Vishnu, he said. Maybe he is referring to Sarupya, having the same features as Vishnu, but he will not become Vishnu. So there is a lot of confusion. You know, what is this moksha? People have no idea. As a term, they know what is moksha, but mostly they just want to be free from miseries. So Prabhupada is explaining about akama. He is saying akama means no material desire. And akama means desirelessness. Many people, they also recommend this, okay, we should be desireless. But as a living entity, Prabhupada explains that no living entity can be desireless. You cannot be free from desires. How desires come, this mechanism is explained in Bhagavad Gita. The desires begin with the contemplation. You start thinking about some sense object, you start thinking about something, and then slowly that turns into a desire. Dhyayata is the first step. So if you want to control the desires, you have to control your contemplation. What are you thinking repeatedly? See, as a practicing sadhaka, we have to be watchful about our thoughts. If the thoughts are regular and so much time you are giving to a particular thought, particular subject, slowly it will turn into a very deep desire. You develop attachment to such subject and it turns into a deep desire. So, more time you give to some subject, that means mind thinks is more important for you. And then it increases the, it reminds you more and more. So that's how the desires develop. So if we are not watchful, then we may develop desires. Desires can be positive desires or negative desires. You may positively wanting to satisfy yourself, or you may, you know, hate or envy somebody else, but these are all desires. So Prabhupada is explaining here, it is not possible to make the desires zero, because contemplation you cannot stop. You will not be able to stop the thoughts. So that's why here he refers to Jiva Goswami's definition of what is desirelessness. It's a fantastic definition. The whole bhakti is summarized here. He says, Bhajaniya Paramapurusha Sukha. Sukha, Sukha Matra. Bhajaniya means by serving Paramapurusha. Prabhupada is referring to Krishna in the very purport beginning as Purushottama. Krishna in Bhagavad Gita has been glorified as Purushottama or the Supreme Personality. So now the same Paramapurusha is been referred by Jiva Goswami here. Bhajaniya Paramapurusha, by serving the Supreme Lord, Sukamatra Swasukatvam. That means by seeing Krishna happy, we become happy. Experiencing happiness of the Supreme Lord, one should feel, Prabhupada is translating here, one should feel happy only by experiencing the happiness of the Supreme Lord. This intuition of this living being is a very important principle. Our entire bhakti is meant for satisfying Krishna. So now Jiva Goswami is saying, one should feel happy by experiencing happiness of the Lord. Sometimes we take our some guests to our schools for midday meal implementation, right? They go and our other feeding programs, Subhojanam, we'll invite those people. You know, the donor or some VIP, he will come. And if you observe, when he starts serving, he'll be smiling. The VIPs and whoever, and although he will be maintains a big profile, as soon as he starts serving, you will see, there is a little smile. Photographs will have that smile. A little smile will be there. Why is that? As soon as that person comes, he serves, that person smiles. Heart, there is a door. And when you see there is a little happiness in that person, you feel happy. That's why these guests, they'll be very happy. Particularly children. Children, they exhibit their happiness quite easily. So as soon as you serve the children, the child is very happy. You can see the happiness in the face of the child. By seeing that happiness, you feel happy. This intuition originally belongs to the Supreme Lord. We see Krishna smiling, happy, and we feel happy. That is the original intuition of the living being. But that original intuition is there, but it is applied wrongly on a wrong object, on an illusory object. If that original intuition is applied to, like here Prabhupada is saying, community, society, family, country, humanity, it's only a partial manifestation of this original feeling. Our feelings will be sampurna, complete, only by seeing, here it is mentioned, Paramapurusha Sukamatra, seeing Krishna happy, then we feel happy. This is the complete development of our internal feelings. What are that? You should feel happy only when Krishna is happy. But then how do you know Krishna is happy or not? Whether he is smiling. If we see Krishna smiling, it's very easy for us. We'll also smile. If Krishna is angry, then we know something has gone wrong. Right? It is not. When Chitraketu, he was traveling on the airplane and he sees Parvati and Shiva are seated together. Parvati is on the, on the lap of Shiva. And then Chitraketu makes a comment on Lord Shiva. And then so all the sages were all seated there, including Narada Muni. They were all looking at Shiva. And Shiva took it very lightly. He just smiled. And he also spoke something to Chitraketu. When he said, he smiled, everybody smiled. Because they want to know what is Shiva's response. Shiva is happy, he is friendly. So they are also friendly. This is very important. We should learn how to derive this kind of a happiness. So it is not possible for a conditioned living entity to directly experience Krishna's happiness. That's why we have to go through the via media of the spiritual master. If the spiritual master is happy, smiling, then that is our happiness. We'll also smile. Right? If we can make Prabhupada happy, then yes, we are also very happy. During this season, the devotees used to go and present the book distribution course to Sri Prabhupada. And Prabhupada used to be very happy. Somebody would come and say, Prabhupada, we did this, so many books, we printed, we published this, so many books. Prabhupada will be very happy. And then he would say, yes, double it. He used to increase their enthusiasm and excitement and ask them to double it. In order to transport this paper, there were special trains to print these books. That many books Prabhupada used to print. Millions and millions. BTGs, millions used to publish, print. And devotees used to, excitingly they used to go and distribute. Why they are getting excitement? Because they are visualizing Prabhupada's happiness. Prabhupada will be very happy. They are very excited. They were anticipating, we will distribute all this, we will go and show to Prabhupada, and Prabhupada, broad smile will be there. That anticipation is driving them. Understood? So that is the real desirelessness. Desirelessness means we want to take pleasure, we want to be happy by seeing Krishna happy. So, in sadhaka stage also, we can experience this by always thinking about Prabhupada's pleasure. When we are doing some service, we should think at the end of it, will Prabhupada smile by seeing this? Let us say you are cleaning some paraphernalia, MMD service, you are cleaning this, temple hall. After cleaning, let us say this temple hall has been cleansed, and let us say Prabhupada comes here. After seeing the whole hall, now what will be Prabhupada's response? Will he be angry or will he be pleased, happy? You are calculating in terms of that happiness. You are visualizing, I should clean very nicely. And Prabhupada should be happy. If Prabhupada comes here, you should say, Hari, very nice. You should say. When Kunti Devi offered prayers to Krishna, Krishna smiled and said, Badam. Very good. He acknowledged. That is the perfection. You have done some glorification, and there is a Mandam Jahasa, there is a mild smile on Krishna's face. That's all. That That is our target. At least some little smile should be there. Okay, so this way we cultivate our relationship with the spiritual master. If Prabhupada is pleased, automatically Krishna is pleased. This is how we need to cultivate our devotional service. Every day when you are doing service, you are thinking in your mind, you are visualizing in your mind, at the end of it, or while doing it, will Prabhupada be pleased? Will he smile on me? You are always in anxiety. To do it nicely, so that Prabhupada is pleased. Once Vishnujana Swami, he approaches Prabhupada and he says, Prabhupada, how to perfect my service? How do I perfect my service? And Prabhupada immediately says, you can perfect your service by your anxiety. Spiritual life doesn't mean no anxiety. Many people outside anxiety, they are harassed. And that's why sometimes they come to spiritual life looking for freedom from anxiety. But actually, the way Prabhupada has given the Krishna consciousness means even anxiety is there in spiritual life. There is an anxiety in Vaikuntha. There is an anxiety here in spiritual life. And what is that anxiety? Anxiety is, will Prabhupada be pleased? And one more thing is that sometimes devotees think, okay, it's ultimately the end result. So let me do whatever, you know, in whatever way is possible, and let me produce a big result. No, in bhakti, the path is also important. How you are going to produce the result, that is also important. One should not think, okay, I will sell some 1,000 Bhagavad Gitas. But then who will purchase 1,000? But if I can give free, so I can give it off 1,000 or 10,000, any number you can give free. But then to give free, I have to get some money. Let me steal money and discount the books and give it off free. One cannot think like that. One should not think, we are only concerned about the final result. Produced or not? No. We are concerned about the path also. How you are going to produce? It should be done in such a way that there is no negative consequence to the organization. There is no negative consequence to your personal life. So that will really please Prabhupada. So that's why here Akama is a very nice paragraph. You know, you all should read this again and again. So that original feeling is there. Prabhupada gives the example of the gopis of Vrindavan. They are the topmost lovers of Krishna. They exhibited the ultimate akama spirit. And Prabhupada also gives the example of Arjuna. Initially, Arjuna has exhibited kind of a sarvakama. He exhibited the spirit of, you know, desiring his own satisfaction. But then finally, after hearing Bhagavad Gita, he decided to satisfy only Krishna. And Prabhupada is writing here very interestingly. He agreed to fight on the instruction of the Lord because he came to his senses and realized that satisfaction of the Lord at the cost of his own satisfaction was his prime duty. This is an important point. While giving satisfaction to Krishna, we may have to compromise. We have to reject our own satisfaction. At the cost of our own satisfaction, we should satisfy the Supreme Lord. Here that is mentioned here, Sukha Matra. Only His Sukha. Only His Sukha. So that development is the Sadhana Bhakti. Day by day we have an opportunity. All day we are doing so many things, so many services. And so we should do it nicely. This is what Madhavan Prabhu also says in those japa modules. After every mantra, you should feel that it will satisfy Guru. Every mantra. When you chant Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama. But then you are doing in such a way that it should be pleasing to Guru. At the end of one mantra, you can think it will please Guru. Since it pleases Guru, you are also happy. Every mantra, you can just say, this will please Guru. It may not be because our quality is so high, but at least he is happy with the number also. Prabhupada said 16 rounds. Now when you chant one mantra, you are little closer to that 16. So Prabhupada is happy. You will think rascal is progressing. He will complete 16. He is happy. That much is enough for us to start with. So very important to understand this principle. This one mantra I should chant in such a way that Prabhupada should be happy. Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare. Same thing applies to honoring prasad. I should honor in such a way that Prabhupada is happy. How? By properly chanting mantras, remembering deities. This prasadam is mercy of the Lord. Remembering that it is building relationship with the Supreme Lord. Lord has very kindly given me this. Be thankful, but don't comment on prasad. Don't pass negative comments. Your mood is relationship. Lord has given me this out of His kindness, mercy. It has come from the Lord, and how can you criticize? That means your sukha you are calculating. It is not tasty, salt is less, so this is less, that is more, this, that, all those things. You are calculating. So if it is pleasing to you, then you are glorifying Krishna. If it is not pleasing to you, then there is a criticism, fault finding, scolding, this, that, everything. That is not the, that is not what Jiva Goswami is saying. So that's why we should be carefully, we should internalize this principle. Let us say Kirtan is going on and somebody is chanting holy names. So Lord has appeared. He is there, kindly has come. You are happy. Lord's presence is there. Don't comment on how good tune or not good tune. One particular tune means I will dance very nicely. But this singer doesn't know. He is singing in his own way. Calculation is on the basis of your own pleasure. Whether you are able to do it or not, it is your pleasure. So very carefully we have to apply this principle and ensure that I am on, at the cost of my own satisfaction, I want to give satisfaction to Krishna. Krishna is happy when you go on chanting. Rhythm, melody, this, that, all these things are okay, additional. It is important, neophyte stage, very important that all these things are important. It should be tasty, should be nice to hear, all there. But then if the devotees understand, even if their holy name, for example, somebody is chanting sincerely, but it may not be melodious, kirtan, doesn't matter. Holy name is there, you are happy, presence is there, Lord's presence is there, you also chant, you also sing. Like that, we have to understand the principle, and each and every scenario we can apply. Now imagine, throughout the day your thinking is about pleasing, that pleasure of Guru is what is driving you, how nice it is. Day by day you are learning this skill, you are learning this important principle. How to visualize my Guru's happiness, and so that I can do it nicely. So that's why such kind of a thinking that my Guru should be pleased, that is called Udharadhi. Udhara means broader. His thinking is broad. If he thinks it's my own senses, my own body, then that is called narrow. If you think about Guru, if you think about Krishna, that is broader outlook. Very simple. Actually, the words of me, you know, gives a lot of meaning. Udharadhi means broad-minded, broader outlook. And what is that? Simply satisfy Guru and Krishna. Okay, so say somebody is not well, sick. His thinking should be, within this, how much I can contribute, how much service I can do, even if he is sick. He is not thinking, now I am sick, so let me take a long big break and then, you know, that's not the mood. The mood is, even if I am very sick, still the devotee is thinking, can I still complete my 16 rounds? Can I still do some service? He is not taking that as an excuse. He is using that also in Krishna's service. There is a big difference between them. So these things you have to understand. At the cost of your own comfort, you may not be well, you are not feeling good. At the cost of your own comfort, you should serve Guru and Krishna. You should serve. Even though you are not feeling well, you are not happy, still you are thinking about happiness of Guru. Very advanced, very intense bhakti this is. That's why tivrena bhakti yogena yajeta purusham param. It's very tivra. Not easy, that kind of a thinking. Even if you are not feeling any happiness, no sukha, still you are thinking about happiness of the spiritual master. That's why it is a tivra. It has to be tivra. Okay, so then that is called pure devotion. Reaching pure devotion is not easy. Only by the blessing of Guru, only by blessing of a pure devotee, you can reach pure devotion. Any questions? Prabhupada ki jai, Srimad Bhagavatam ki jai.